everybody, and welcome. Thank you all for joining us today. Today's topic is Build for Everyone, Products and the Spaces They Occupy. A quick Zoom tip before we get started, we will have automated captioning services for the entirety of this session through Otter AI. So to turn on that feature, please click on the bottom screen of Zoom and click closed caption, then show subtitles, and that will turn on this feature. With that, let's get started. My name is Bridget Manos, and I'll be your MC for the afternoon. As we get started, we would love to know where everybody's joining from and what piqued your interest about today's session that led you to join. So go ahead and pop that into the chat. And while you do, I'm going to provide you with some additional details for today. So during the conversation today, we do encourage you to engage with your fellow community members in the chat. We also will have AnitaB.org team members in the chat addressing comments and sharing additional resources. We will have a Q&A section at the end of the conversation. So if you do have a question for one of the panelists, please use the Q&A function and we'll try to get to as many as possible. Now, this is a big one. In this conversation, there will be knowledge shared and things that resonate with you directly. So feel free to use the hashtag AnitaBElevates on any of your social media to share those gems. Again, that's hashtag AnitaBElevates. So for you, those of you just joining us, welcome. We're getting ready to kick off this conversation with our amazing panelists from Google. So without further ado, let's get started. I have the great pleasure of introducing our president and CEO of AnitaB.org, Brenda Darden Wilkerson. Brenda, take it away.
Thanks so much, Bridget, and welcome everyone. I'm looking at where everybody's coming in from all over the world. Thank you so much for joining us. So I want to welcome you to our Elevating Conversation series and also to today's conversation, which has been generously sponsored by Google. During our time together, we will explore different products made by Google and the purpose they hold in our lives, which is particularly important during the pandemic when we are heavily reliant on technology to stay productive and connected. From leveraging the support of calendar reminders to keep us on schedule throughout the day, to making online purchases of various varieties, to searching for a video on how to say, I don't know, make a new recipe. The variety of software resources we access daily is diverse and unending, and I am personally grateful. However, if there is one thing in common among these kinds of Google tools we will learn about today, it's that they are created with their users in mind, and we know how important that is. Google has a mantra that goes like this: focus on the user and all else will follow. With the intent to provide solutions and delight users, Googlers across various teams work together to create a myriad of products and to also enable and support all kinds of work from product development to business innovation. Whether it's application infrastructure and reliability, building scalable cross-platform shopping experiences, or perhaps developing and applying deep learning research to make Google products more effective, there's a lot of work being done, which contributes to various products and ultimately to all of us, their users. Today, we will hear from three of Google's leaders who will share their personal experiences and insights on products and products that they've worked on. And they're also going to elaborate on the mentality and collaborative efforts that go into the process of building Google products at scale. So allow me to introduce today's panelists. First, we have Michelle Duffy. Michelle has been working in the tech industry since 1992, first as an individual contributor, and since 2006 as an engineering manager. Her career has spanned large and small organizations from e-commerce to travel, specializing in building and growing efficient teams. At Google, she is responsible for core infrastructure powering GSuite, including identity management and access policies across all GSuite products. This involves setting strategic direction for and leading a globally distributed organization of more than 80 people, working closely with product development and partner teams across GSuite and Google Cloud. Now, here's a fun fact. In 2010 and 11, Michelle and her husband took their kids out of school for a year and backpacked around the world, visiting 29 countries. That is amazing. Welcome, Michelle. Next, we have Samantha Lemonnier. Samantha is Director of Engineering at Google and is responsible for shopping property consumer experience. Previously, Samantha worked on the Google Advertiser platform, including campaign management and AdWords Next. She has extensive experience building large-scale front-end applications in the industry before joining Google in 2005. Now, here's another fun fact. Samantha has snorkeled with sharks on three different occasions in Belize and Bora Bora. Okay, these are adventurous people. Welcome, welcome. Next, we have Megan Kacholia. Megan is a vice president of engineering within Google's research organization and a longtime Googler. Her passion is building effective teams and addressing barriers to help all Googlers do their best work. Her team's work spans machine learning in research as well as production. Previously, Megan had a long tenure in Google's ads organization, where she ran the serving system for Google's display ads business. She is also co-creator and sponsor of Google's Senior Tech Women Spotlight video series, an internal video series for women at Google that features a different senior tech woman each month, showcasing that there is no one-size-fits-all path to success. We all have our own stories, and I could not agree more. Now, here's a fun fact. She has been a doggy midwife, helping her golden retriever Hazel deliver her 5 puppies 2 years ago. Again, this just proves my point. Tech women have more fun. Okay. Can we just all agree to that? So let's get started. Welcome, everyone. I'm so excited for this conversation, and I'm so excited for all the things that everyone is going to share. So I want to start out by saying, I want everybody to respond to this one. First of all, how are you doing? And please share with our audience your background in tech, your path to Google, and what you're working on right now. And Samantha, why don't you start?
Hello, everyone. I'm Samantha. It's very nice to meet you all virtually. This is super exciting for me as well to join this event and meet you all in this new world. For my background in tech, I actually first started in research, focusing on speech recognition. So it was a lot of fun and super interesting. But at one point I just realized, research is actually not my calling, right? I was more interested in building product based on the technology instead of writing research papers about technology and research. So then I decided to jump into the startup world in the late 90s. So I learned a lot. That was a really great experience. I learned a lot from the startup world. And I had a lot of fun, right? I met a lot of people as well. So by early 2005, I've been working on the startup world for about a few years, built a lot of experiences. And I also got married and I had 2 wonderful baby boys. So that is the time, with the increased demand at home. So it was time to move on from the startup world. So that's how I ended up at Google in 2005. So within Google, I worked on infrastructures, a lot of things. The infrastructures, Google Health and Google Ads, as you mentioned earlier. And about 2.5 years ago, I switched to Google Shopping. So I've been working on the consumer experiences for Google Shopping ever since.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for sharing. I can't wait to hear more. So Megan, tell us everything.
So, I would say my path to tech is probably a little non-traditional. I did not do anything with coding or anything like that until I was in college, actually, my freshman year. And it was by accident, not by design. I was very undecided about what to pursue. The school I went to University of Illinois, and they actually allow you to be undecided for 2 years, which I think my parents were like, oh my God, like, is she gonna make a career? But I was like, I don't know. I thought I could do business, accounting, I like math. and I happened to take a computer science for non-computer science majors class, and there was an honors section in it where we got to do like scripting basically. And I loved it. It was so cool. It was so logical, right? You could like produce things. It was amazing. And I decided to try and see if I could switch into computer science. And I did. I dove into some of the classes. I worked hard to make sure I could still finish within 4 years. And got a lot of help along the way. I think looking back, it's always those points where you make a decision and you don't realize later how pivotal it was. One of those little moments mm-hmm. for me was when deciding to move into computer science, they recommended you meet with a dean, right? Because you had to apply to switch colleges. I was switching from liberal arts to engineering, and that you can't just do that. You have to apply to do those things. And I met with one of the deans, and he was like, oh, let me see your grades. Midterms are in. And he's like, would you like to switch today? I'm like, haha, you're funny. I'm like, yeah, sure, I'd love to switch today. That's great. Then he's like, okay, done. Right, printed out a piece of paper, signed it.
Oh, awesome.
Grades here. And I took it back to my advisor, and she's like, "That's you're lying. That's not what happened. You misunderstood," like rolling their eyes at me, I'm like, paper. She's like, oh my God, he switched you. So just those moments. Even coming to Google was similar. I was thinking about getting a PhD. I wasn't sure what I wanted to do next. Google came on campus to do interviews. I just happened to see the flyer in the school newspaper, decided why not, you know, let's see what happens. I got the interview. They flew me out to California for second round. I was like, oh my gosh, California is so much better than Illinois. Right? Like they offered me a job. I'm like, you're going to pay me. I'm like, I will take said job. And I've been there for 15 years, and I've learned so much. Worked from being an individual contributor. My best language was Lisp when I joined Google. Like that is not a commonly used language. Like mm-hmm. I had so much to learn, but I was just, I wanted to learn. I think that is the biggest thing is I love learning and diving in. And that has served me well over the years. Moved from IC to tech lead to then tech lead manager. They're like, you have people skills. We should have you manage people. Not all of our engineers do this. So just took on more and more of it. And over a year ago, promoted to VP. I never expected my path to be like this. I've been so just thrilled and honored with all the amazing people I've worked with. But I love thinking back about those, like I said, those pivotal moments where you just kind of make a decision and look back later and be like, huh, like that few minutes of thinking, like look where it led me. But yeah, that's my story.
That's amazing. And it's similar to my story because I'm an accidental computer scientist as well, getting into it in college. And so for all of you out there who want to know, can I change my mind? Yes, you can. That's awesome. Okay. Thank you, Megan. Okay. Michelle, your turn.
Okay. Hi, folks. It's super exciting for me to be on this panel today. It's kind of amazing to see all of the people from all the different places saying hi on the chat. So hi to all of you. Okay, so my story for computer science and how did I get to where I am? I actually grew up in Ireland, and there was no option to do any computer science in my high school. It wasn't an official subject at the time. And so I also have two boys, and when I look at what they're both in their 20s, and when I look at what they've been able to do online in their high schools, it just blows my mind, the difference. But Ireland in the 90s was, in the 80s was not a very pleasant place. It was kind of disadvantaged. So I chose on a whim to gamble on computer science being a growing place where I could get a job. Never touched a computer, didn't know what programming involved, but chose a degree in computer science and business administration. Kind of like Megan, I'm like, I can do math. I know I can work hard at math. And here we go. And so it was a total gamble, but I graduated and then worked for the next 10 years as a developer in Ireland first, and then I moved to the US in 1995. I worked until about 2005 as a regular developer using scary client server systems. I feel so old to say that.
What does that mean?
The client server, yes, exactly. Don't tell them. And then in 2005, while I was at Amazon, I took a role managing a team and focusing on infrastructure scalability and reliability. And I really haven't looked back since. What I've done is I've moved since then from working on developer teams, building products, to focusing on infrastructure. And a friend of mine refers to us as the plumbers that just keep all the stuff moving. And that's what excites me. It excites me to figure out these problems to keep all of these systems that are up, that people depend on, up and running all the time. So I joined Google in 2010 after taking a year off to travel with my husband and kids, which I'm hugely thrilled that we were able to do. But I worked in display ads, then site reliability engineering for ads. And then since January this year, I've been with Google Workspace Space. And since that product name is so new, some of you will know it as GSuite. I'm currently, like you said, responsible for the infrastructure behind the identity and policy management for the Workspace products. So that's my story.
I just love hearing all just background and how we get there, because it just shows that there's so many ways to get into tech and then to just you know, knock it out of the park as these leaders are doing. And I'm so happy to hear your story. So thank you for sharing. So since we're going to talk about products today, I would love to hear what products each of you use the most in your day to day. And so Michelle, you just finished. So what can you tell us? What products do you use most?
Well, I work in Workspace, so of course I'm going to stay Workspace, right? But seriously, and by Workspace, I mean Sheets, Docs, Meet, the whole nine yards. But the serious point is I'm a new lead since January in an organization that's had to make a very hard pivot this year in response to COVID and in response to so many of the customers, the businesses and individual users that depend on our products doing everything from home. And so it's a little sad, but I do spend most of my days at the moment in video conferences via Google Meet, writing or revising plans in Google Docs, and then communicating with teams via chat and email. That said, the systems that I'm responsible for were heavy users of Google storage technologies like Spanner, Google Spanner that you guys and people can read the papers about, and of course gRPC, and as well as a whole bunch of more internal Google services and products. In fact, the thing I would say, and some of this stuff is publicly, like, because identity is our main bailiwick, anything like that you can read about the global identity management and GFE front ends that Google uses for service authentication and protection security, that's where I am, basically.
Awesome. What about you, Megan?
I definitely use a lot of video conferencing, a lot of Google Meet these days. Sheets, and I love spreadsheets. I'm sorry, I love formulas and being able to plot things out. Sometimes it's so nice to deal with like that stuff versus always all the human problems too. That email and chat for sure. I think kind of within my teams, people use a lot of different platforms and things like that for machine learning. So there are multiple that Google has, like TensorFlow, and then Jax is a newer, smaller one. So there's a lot of experience with that and hearing folks working with those types of things. But yeah, for me personally, definitely it's a lot of email and chat. I get to use a lot of Google Classroom to help my son with remote learning. So there's lots of things I've become tech support for at home. Those are the main ones, I would say.
Well, that's a symptom of being a technologist. You're everybody's tech support, you know?
That's correct.
We just have to face that.
And people love to ask you, can you fix this thing on YouTube for me? No, I can't. I'm sorry.
Right? I mean, it's just, whatever. What are we going to do? So, Samantha, what about you?
So for me, I think the calendar by far is the most important app for me. You know, my calendar basically runs my life at work and at home. I have one funny story about calendar that I love. The feature I love was that when my son was at maybe 12 or something like that, and I started using calendar. I started putting everything that we do at home on the personal calendar, like the Google calendar. So the one day I said, hey, do you know you have to do this? He said, Mom, I already know. The Google just told me. So that was hilarious. But I didn't realize because they didn't know that. He didn't put it on my calendar. I put it on their calendar. So then the reminder from their phone, I said, whoa, I got it. The Google knows. So it was pretty funny story. So that is definitely the number one, right? So I learned from one of the, actually the women's forum, how to manage your life, right? That emails, we have so many emails, so many chats. So how do you manage? Then one of the advice I took was using calendar to kind of organize your life so you know how to manage your time better. So that was definitely one of the things. Just add a little bit small things onto what Megan and Michelle said earlier about career. Just want to add a note. I actually started studying electrical engineering. And later on, I switched to a computer engineering just to test it.
Yeah. I mean, and then I know it was very common when I was in undergraduate school for people to start in electrical engineering. I started in biomedical engineering. So yeah, it's, you know, you got to discover, you got to figure out what you want to do, right?
Yeah.
So, and I totally agree. If it's not on my calendar, it's not happening. So my whole life is on my calendar. Totally agree. So this is great. So, you know, as a lot of folks are working from home these days, you know, we started this whole series around the pandemic to, you know, talk about leadership in this time and really how to address how our lives have changed. The way we interact and collaborate with one another has shifted totally, right? So in what ways have you seen change or new trends in the way users are interacting with Google products to collaborate? And how about, Michelle, you start.
So new trends in the way users are collaborating with Google. Okay, so I'm glad that Megan gave me a segue into this. She mentioned that her children use Classroom. So the Classroom product, one of the educational products that Google offers, it actually relies on the infrastructure that I'm responsible for. So you're welcome, Megan. I was just reading a news article yesterday. This was in an Indian newspaper, but I think the point still holds. It says that they believe that one of the long-lasting impacts of COVID and change from work from home is going to be in the world of educational technology with this, you know, opportunity for more blended classrooms assisting people. And so for me personally, that because I manage the teams that have been responsible for scaling and making Google able to support literally tens of millions of educational systems around the world move on to Classroom and similar products using each. I mean, I know many schools use Zoom, but the ones that are using our products, like, that's been my story this year. From beginning in April with, I won't name, but a brand name large East Coast city in the US, spending the entire weekend working with them, through until, you know, a 100 million user onboarding in the last few weeks from somewhere in Southeast Asia. And so that has been my life since April.
Amazing. And I know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just want to throw in there, you know, as we talk about this, this is part, I feel really excited to be part of tech, given how tech is serving us at this time, right? That we, you know, if you think about the difference in how our lives would be if we didn't have these tools, right? So very exciting and satisfying. So, yeah. So how about you? Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, for the year, when we did travel for a year with our kids, we homeschooled. Like, I lived in Seattle at the time. The Seattle School District allows you to register your child very simply. Fill out a form. There you go. And you're homeschooled. But we had to buy books. I had to do research. I had to figure out, like, how am I going to keep these kids? Whereas now, like, I completely empathize with every single parent out there who's trying to keep their, you know, be home parent as well as home teacher. It's not easy, and the technology is not quite where it needs to be, but everything has improved so much. It's so exciting to see.
Yeah. I don't know how parents are doing it, and I certainly don't know how they would do it without the technology. So true. Okay. How about you, Samantha?
So, from a shopping side, we actually experienced some interesting changes as well, right? So due to the, when we started in the COVID, everybody is starting to stay home. Nobody's going out. All the malls are closed. All the shops are closed. So it was, in a way, it's not surprising, but it was a surprising for us just to see the uptick of the traffic for the online shopping, right? We definitely see that hit really, really quickly. And also that the user are also looking for more information about shopping, right? You can't actually go to the mall to check out the things and then go to the local store anymore. So that part of the researching of a product also changed a bit. And then also the demand in additional information had increased a lot too, right? For example, which store actually offer curbside pickup? Even though the stores closed, that became a big thing, right? And also the local stores, which one actually opened, which one is closed? On top of that, there was also that, you know, that small business, right? So there's small business and local stores are affected a lot. Actually, a lot of people are willing to, wanted to help the local business. So we actually saw that demand. So we actually developed features to allow people find the small business, adding a small business filter. So that was a really interesting shift, even for the shopping. So it's quite interesting.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And I just want to say, ladies, you are helping us generate amazing conversations in the chat. And I just want to share with everybody out there, if you have questions, because we're going to get to your questions in just a little bit, make sure you put them in the Q&A. So Megan, talk to us about changes you've seen.
I think kind of more on the research side, I don't think we've seen as much change in terms of how things have operated, but I do think it's hard for people to just figure out how to get past some of the collaboration barriers, right? There's like this crazy amount of fatigue just from doing the online video conferencing all the time. I mean, I think you feel that so much more than when you're doing in-person meetings, which is something that I've seen a lot, just kind of as a leader, kind of seeing how my managers, how the folks in my team are doing, right? Just handling all of that, I think, has been one big thing that we've been trying to figure out how to deal with better. I think on the, you know, there's pluses and minuses, right? In some sense, it evens out the field a little bit. So folks who were before in distributed sites, who are always like, man, I can't get a word in edgewise with, you know, home base, they just won't stop talking to each other. Now they can get in a word more. But I've noticed for folks who are quieter, it's hard sometimes for them to jump in on GBC because the verbal cues and the visual cues are all screwed up depending on what your lag and stuff is like. So you have to find more creative ways to then make it so people can interact better, honestly. I found even the closed captioning feature is actually useful for this because sometimes someone will be trying to say something and it'll pick up like a word and you're like, oh, someone's trying to talk, like, who is it? But there's, you know, there's different tips and tricks you pick up to try and help make sure that people can still interact well, especially in bigger forums.
Absolutely. And, you know, that brings me to the next question, because it's so important as we get our work done, and especially for those of us who are creating products and services for users, and we want to make sure that they work for users, we have to be able to collaborate ourselves. And so I would love to hear you guys talk about how do completely different teams at Google impact each other? How do you work together? How do you cross-pollinate? How do you take the feedback that you're getting in all these just diverse areas and products and have it have an impact on your product? So who wants to start? I'll throw that out. Who'd like to start to respond to that?
I'm happy to jump in kind of just on the research org perspective. So I think one of the most interesting things about being in research is figuring out kind of the time mismatch that you have with the product areas. So in the sense that, you know, products will be worrying about, like, ads might be like, I have these revenue goals that I have to hit in, you know, Q4 or Q1 or Q2. There's these, you know, 6-month timeframe things that they're trying to figure out. Whereas on the research side, we might be like, that's nice. We really want to think about 2 to 3 years out. All right. And so it's very hard sometimes to have some of those conversations and make sure you're not talking past each other just because of the timing mismatch. And that's where just figuring out how to talk better to each other. I don't know when to check in with the teams. Like, okay, it's great to come to them and say, like, okay, you know, YouTube, what are some of the biggest things that you're thinking about in terms of new product innovation, right? Or, you know, different things you'd love to see ML be able to do for you that it's not doing well now, right? But we can't promise it next quarter, but we want to know for the next 1 to 2 years so that we can start figuring out how to deliver and then figuring out when to go back with those updates to make sure that their, you know, timelines didn't change, the priorities didn't shift. But it's really cool when those things work out. I think like a recent one that that I use all the time is even just the smart compose features in Gmail, where it's, you know, it automatically tells, like, it fills in the person's name so you don't misspell their name. Like, that's like, it's a faux pas you don't want to do. It's really cool just how we were able to work with product teams to do these things that help make it easier for people. I love it when those things actually then get into products and seeing where the research leads.
Yeah, absolutely. How about you, Samantha?
From our side, actually, this is really interesting. Cross-work collaboration is a big thing for shopping, right? Because if you think about user, we try to be, like you said earlier, we try to be user-focused. If you think about user, they shop everywhere, right? So, you know, it might be on YouTube, all of a sudden say, oh, I saw this product, I might want to shop for it. And same as our maps. So we definitely work very closely with the, you know, local team, right, maps team and a YouTube team to see how we can create a holistic, you know, seamless shopping experience. So the cross work, cross team collaboration become very, very, very important for us. I think the biggest thing is actually really just kind of like what Megan says, you just have to talk to people, right? Make sure that you actually stay in touch with each other to understand each other, you know, the roadmaps, the goals, what user problem we're trying mm-hmm. to solve, which part of the user problems are similar, which part of the user problems are unique to a surface, because we don't really want to overly being consistent per se, right? So consistency is important, but we don't want to be overly consistent just in case that user is in a different place, different surface, they might have a different needs. So we really want to put the user, we want to meet user where they are. So that collaboration become very important to address the differences as well as try to reuse the infrastructure. So that is kind of one of the key things we do here for cross-work collaboration. For the COVID, I just want to add one more thing to what Megan said. She was absolutely right about, you know, what's the upside and downsides. But I do see one other upside. I'm a ultimate optimistic person, so I see positive things all the time. So one of the positive things was that I feel like the meetings actually become a little bit more inclusive because everybody's online, right? Just like a Zoom meetings or a Google Meet, you're online. If you have two or three people talking at the same time, nobody can hear anything, right? In the past, it would be, you know, in a meeting, you have two or three small meetings going on and then people just felt like left out. But now it's like everybody has to respect other people's time. You really have to stop, listen, and then go to the next person. So in a way, I thought that's a really nice plus. So people have to raise their hand, right? We have the raise your hand feature and people are paying attention and say, oh, who raised their hand first? So I thought it was a really, really nice thing, especially for people quieter. There are some downsides too, but there was also some upsides. So they had a chance to speak as well.
Yeah, we're definitely learning how to make good in this new world. I remember attending meetings where they were in person, but I was dialing in because I couldn't fly in. It was a totally different experience. Now we're all there, right? We're all able to see each other. And it does bring us closer as well as, you know, present challenges. If there's 300 of you, right, and you know, then you don't get to contribute. But again, the technology, we're figuring it out as we go along based upon how we're working it. And so Michelle, I want to hear from you too. You know, talk to us about, you know, the types of things that you're seeing.
Well, I think the cross-pollination point for me is like the workspace development teams are globally spread. So we have teams in India and Bangalore, in Europe, in Stockholm, in Zurich, in New York, in Waterloo, in Boulder, here, and in Seattle, right? Wow. And so, because it's a big org with a lot of different products, right? But a lot of things that have happened this year have really forced a lot of cross-team collaboration in terms of as we pivoted on the fly. And so not just practically like everybody else has said, learning how to work with everybody being a remote party, but also then having to coordinate. So for example, when coordinate across all of those time zones and take advantage of the time zones. So for example, in April, May, when Meets usage was hockey sticking up due to classroom coming on board in many, many different regions, as well as just like everybody switching to working from home, they had like what I think of as a once in a lifetime scaling problem, right? So it was like 30x gross, just like that. And nobody could have predicted when they were making their budgetary or capacity forecast for last year that was gonna happen. So they ran a multi-week, multi-site, like global incident to keep ahead of what was going on. And so that inclusivity sounds, it's difficult to say, oh, well, that was inclusive. But if that had not been during COVID, if it had been pre-COVID, it likely would have been one team in one site figuring out a problem and then distributing the information. But given COVID, everybody had to be involved and figure out how to make all that work and how then cooperate with the rest of Google, as well as communicate with our customers. So that's been a very practical experience for me. And in that sort of situation.
Yeah, I mean, and of course, this is a trifling example of what you're talking about. But this webinar series brings people together around the clock, right? We get people in India, in Europe. It's in the middle of the night. So thank you to all of you guys who are up late with us. But the ability to do that, right, we wouldn't necessarily make some of these choices. But so this is some of the lemonade that I think is being made. Obviously, the sun never sets on your entire collective team because it's all over the world, right? So that's great. So I just want to ask one more question. There's so much more. We could talk forever, but I do want to let the audience begin to get some of their questions asked. But the one question I want to ask you before we go, just if you could quickly answer, what are some of the most exciting products that you get to work on now? What are you most excited about?
I could start on a.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
So on the shopping side, we're actually doing a lot of exciting stuff. The most exciting stuff, things that we've been working on, is that during a COVID, right, we want to help users and helping the merchant and ecosystem. We have introduced, launched the free listing, so you can, for the merchants, now you can actually sell your product or listing your product for free on Google. So that has a huge impact on the merchants as well as user. So the user basically can see more options. So they have a higher satisfactions, all that. And on merchant side, they feel like they have increased in traffic to their side. So that is kind of exciting. And then we also working on some price related features for our user on Google Shopping, that to help user to find the best price, the price comparison, price insights, price notification, all those things that I feel like really can help user and make a difference for everybody's daily lives. So I'm super excited about working on those areas.
Excellent. Okay. Megan, you go.
Yeah, thank you. So I think for me, look, there's a lot of exciting stuff happening in machine learning and how it's used across Google. I think one of the things that's most exciting for me personally right now is seeing how much Google is doing to try and fold our AI principles into everything that we're doing, right? So how do you make sure that you're being fair in your data sets and not introducing a reinforcing bias, right? How do you make sure that the type of research that we're doing or the way we're releasing our products, it's actually, inclusive to different types of communities, right? How do you make sure it's accessible to different people in different places? I find this to be really exciting. I think it's challenging for sure, because there are lots of different things that you have to think about, lots of different things that we're asking our researchers, our engineers to think about upfront, versus kind of thinking about it after the fact.
Right.
If you do stuff as bolt-on, it doesn't work. It reminds me of how Google went through a lot of this stuff with privacy years ago, right? Where all of a sudden everyone's like, oh my gosh, we have to be really careful with this stuff. We need to be, make sure that we're putting all these processes in place upfront. And I think that's where we're starting to get with AI principles as well. And I find that really exciting, just to see how we really are trying to be responsible about it.
That's awesome. Very important. Michelle.
So this is going to sound a little less exciting compared to what Megan and Samantha have been able to talk about. But hey, I'm an infrastructure person. And so, as you all know, one of the core powerful things about using Docs and Sheets and even Gmail with like the audit is the fact that we are able to collaborate in real time, right? I can put a comment on a doc and you can see me writing. And then the first time I saw it, my mind was blown, because I had come from
me too.
Competitive product that we're using with. However, today, even in the last sort of couple of months, there are significant regulatory changes happening in regions like entire regions like Europe, where people are legitimately wanting to have more control over who can access the data in any situation and what is the what is a better way for us to look at this going forward in terms of personal privacy, but also data access by governmental agencies and law enforcement, all that kind of thing. And so this creates a fascinating technical challenge for the systems that I work with, not just the stuff that, you know, my teams are responsible for, but also our partner teams that underpower like identity management for all of Google and all of Google Cloud, and actually even the ad systems, right? Because a lot of these things is infrastructure that's used by all the Google products. And so I'm working closely with those folks. We're talking to lawyers, but the regulatory situation is changing sometimes on a daily basis. I mean, California, we had our election, there was a proposition, was this going to pass or not going to pass? And so I know, kind of boring compared to Samantha's ability to help individual merchants list their things, but hugely impactful in the long run, I think, for everybody. So I'm super
excited. Very important. And very important. Very important. Love those lawyers. Anyway, okay. Want to give our audience a chance to ask questions. So I'm going to turn it back over to you, Bridget.
Awesome. Thank you, everybody. That was really great. We do have a lot of questions, so I'll just jump right in. I know we talked a bit about how important collaboration is. So this question kind of touches on that. How do you prioritize creative collaboration with other groups in this time in your busy schedules, but especially during the pandemic?
I'm happy to jump in to start with. I think a lot of it will depend on the area that you're in, right? Because different teams are going to have a different mix of kind of the risky longer term things versus the immediate bets that they have to work on. And so I think that'll definitely impact this. So for me, I'm on the research side. So we're definitely going to be focusing a lot more on some of these longer term initiatives. We get to collaborate with folks internally as well as externally, partnering with universities and things like that as well. I do think it has helped, honestly, to cut down on travel and things like that for a lot of people. People get so much fatigue from having to travel and go and be in person to see each other for meetings and different things, or feel like the only way to really participate is to be included, you know, in the in-person venue versus being like Brenda was saying, like being the one who is, you know, on the VC being like, I'm here too. So I think just doing more to make sure people talk with each other as much as possible, try and figure out how to get that whiteboarding feel back to it, right? Where you could go up to the whiteboard and draw and come up with some cool ideas together. I think that's really important just to helping things stay creative. But really it's just about communication, knowing people, talking to people, talking across teams, building up connections and keeping them, because they really do circle back later on. At least to me, that's how I've seen collaboration and just kind of this, especially really exciting forward-looking collaboration really happen.
I can add a bit to what Megan says. I think we already work a lot cross sites, right? For example, shopping, we have a team in Zurich, we have a team in Pittsburgh and many other locations. So it was already like that before the COVID. The travel is one thing I miss, actually. You know, I used to travel to different sites and then get face-to-face time. It was kind of fun. However, I think that interruption was only at the very beginning. So there's another thing I actually found that was really good, was that after the COVID started, I actually enjoy working from home a lot, and it enabled me to be able to have more meetings with Zurich. Because, you know, I roll out of bed at 7:30, I could just jump into a video call, right? Before I would have said, oh, I need to get ready and go to work and all that stuff. So actually created some time in our morning time to collaborate with other teams. That was actually really good, really, really good. And overall, after a couple of months, once we get used to the COVID, I felt like we caught up. I think that we still prioritize collaboration just like before, right? And as long as we communicate, not in person, but you know, we cannot have dinner and lunch with people anymore, but GV, you know, video conferencing works just fine for me.
I think the one thing I would add to this is that there's the individual layer, the management responsibility, and then sort of between teams. And this question comes up for me a lot with individuals that I work with. Like, how do you make time to have time to think, come up with ideas when you're always in meetings? Because that is not just someone like me who's this is part of my job, but also, you know, the senior principal engineers I work with, right? And I try and encourage folks to always make sure that you have some block of time in the week, even if it's only a short block of time, that you get time to work on your project work. Because if you don't do that, then you roll on week over week and you've not had time to significantly contribute or generate ideas for your space. And then the same echoes up at the different organizational levels. So I guess my summary message is you have to conscientiously make time for creative activities. And it's really easy to drop that. It's like exercise. Yeah, I'll do it tomorrow. But you have to make the time to do it. And then, you know, we're in the middle of our 2021 planning and we're trying to figure out how to balance that requests for future work versus in investment in infrastructure. And that leads to some interesting conversations about the balance between creativity and just normal stuff. And then and that would echo the points that the others have made. COVID, once we all settled into it, has helped in terms of cross-team collaboration, particularly because we don't have to travel. We all can adjust our schedules and it is easier to be more mindful of the different time zones, and that's helping the collaboration, at least from my visibility.
That's really awesome. And I like the positive spin to it as well. So we do have another really good question from the attendees here. It's, how has the industry changed since you joined? And two-parter, where do you see it going?
Okay, as the old fart in the group, I will get started here. And I hope that's a polite American phrase to use. But when I started in 1992, it was a pretty sexist place to work. There were very few women engineers where I was working. And a little bit of ridicule for being the woman on the team. And I think that's changed a lot. And it's changed a lot through some painful things, right? Like we've had sort of memos and the like that we've all had to deal with. But there's more awareness that we have to pay attention to differences in order to make sure we have balanced perspectives, both in the product development, feature goals, as well as in the composition of our teams. So I think that's huge. And I'd like to see that continue.
Yeah, I just want to echo, I've seen that even just in kind of in my career, even just at Google in the last 15 years. I think one of the most striking things for me is that it feels much more acceptable and much more normal to call out what we'll say is like poor behavior or call out microaggressions and call out these types of things. I it is not something that I really felt like I noticed or felt empowered to do when I first started in my career or even in college, right? You just didn't call those things out because you were just supposed to deal with it, right? And it has become much clearer to everyone that that's not acceptable and that you should be calling it out. And, you know, you need people to be allies as well to help call out all the different types of behaviors against, you know, all the different underrepresented groups, not just gender-based. But I think that has been one of the biggest things I've seen. I would love to see that continue going forward as well and just see more leaders from underrepresented groups. I think it's very hard for people when they look up to the top and be like, what's the leadership? Who are the people in charge? And they're like, oh, I have nothing in common with them, like nothing. And so then it's so hard to picture yourself in that position or picture yourself wanting to be in that position. Cause you're like, I don't want their life, right? Like, therefore I don't want their job. Right. And it's, you know, I would love to see that change more. That's, I really think, and I think we can make that happen. It takes time, unfortunately, but there has been progress and there's more just notice of it, I would say.
Yeah, I think I also noticed a huge improvement, actually. I think both socially and as well as in the tech industry, right? They are kind of related. As Michelle and Megan already mentioned earlier, if you go back 10, 15 years ago, it's so different, right? How people talk about things and then how you feel like you just have to deal with it. There's nobody's gonna talk about diversity or about unconscious bias that's happened during the last 10 years, right? I think Megan, I think we used to be on some forum, women's forum in Google together also. That even changed a lot, right? I feel like leadership awareness and entire society awareness that is gradually changing. The Me Too movement also, I think, helped a lot, right? It brought it in a society as well as in the tech industry, so how to talk about this kind of thing. One thing I'm hoping for the future is that women in tech will become a more of a normal thing. So more girls will get into it. If you think about when we grew up, right? I remember I chose the not the liberty arts, Megan, just like I considered as well, right? My teacher said, you could go both. So they'll consider it both. I felt like there is a society dilemma for some girls to go into tech. It's just like, oh, it's too nerdy, right? So I don't want that nerdy image and it's just not very cool. I feel like part of it also because it's harder to be successful in that field. So I'm hoping that from even middle school and high school, college, we can see the increase, the interest and an acceptance of women in tech, right? So one of the things I remember when I was 10 years old is that there's this even teacher talk about, wow, the boys are just better in math. Right? So we know that's not true. Some people will say that. I feel that that has come the long way. I really want that to start from school, all equal, you know, telling my boys, you know, your mom can do math, so all girls can do math as well. So that's what I want to see.
I'm sitting here just going, yes, yes. But I know we definitely echo all of your comments at Anita B. So one last quick question. I know we have time for one more. What is one piece of advice you would give yourself just starting out?
Don't be afraid to ask for what you want or what you need, because if you don't ask, the answer's already no. And just don't be afraid to ask.
Yeah, for me is that if I'm looking back, I felt like I was not as intentional as I should be for career growth, right? I would just kind of go with the flow. I think it's very similar to what Megan says, you have to ask, but in order for you to ask, you have to have the intention that, you know, the career is a thing that early on. So I feel like a mentor would be super, super helpful. I only started to have mentors after Google, actually because of the Google diversity effort. And then starting to pay attention to say, oh, you need a mentor for women. And I got one, it's so helpful. I think if you're earlier in your career, don't ask for mentors, ask for help, ask for advice, how you progress, that'll help you a lot.
I'll echo something that Ruth Porat, who's Google's CFO, when she came to Google, I was fortunate enough to be part of a group. And I mean, it wasn't a small group. There's probably a few hundred people in the room where she gave a talk to women technologists, right? And one of the things she said, she was talking about her time in the last financial crisis when she was sort of juggling kids and family and the awesome responsibility she had at the time. And she said something like, you can pay for help, you know, you're worth it. And it's worth your time. And I mean, I think about that all of the time over the course of my career, particularly after my second son was born and I was working as a database engineer at Amazon. Our on-call schedules were horrendous. This was before any of some of the things that we've talked about that are positive. So I was both a new mom and two kids, an anomaly working on call in a fast growing business. And I stopped working. I chose to stop working to solve the juggle that I was dealing. Whereas if someone around me had said, you know, you can pay for help, I might have actually stayed working. And I mean, I'm not sure things would have been very much different. I'm happy with what has happened in my life since then. But that whole concept of like your long-term career investment is worth the money that you might spend today to help you keep everything under control. It was a completely new concept to me. And this is something I heard her say maybe 5 years ago when it was like way past useful for me. So hopefully it's useful for someone who's on this call.
I know Ruth talked at some of the women leadership events that Google has held over the years. And there was one that she spoke at where she said, you know, a career is a jungle gym, not a ladder. I'm like, oh my gosh, yes. Like, yes. And I know I've even experienced this personally myself, you know, when I changed within Google Teams, like moving from, I was in ads for a long time, I moved to research, and I had people being like, what are you doing? You're giving up your team. You know, you have a fast path, you know, to better career. You can get to VP fast. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go from 220 people down to 8. And I'm going to do it. I want to do this. My gut's telling me to do it. And that's it. It's fine. All right. It worked out fine. But you know, it's sometimes doing some of those things where you're like, I want to take the change, even if to someone else, it doesn't look like I'm just immediately taking the right next steps. It's the right next step for me. I love that saying, career is a jungle gym, not a ladder. So stop forcing yourself to make it a ladder.
These are such fantastic pieces of advice. And if I could just add to it, I would say, don't get in your own way. Don't be so cerebral that you overthink things and you talk yourself out of opportunities. You know, I'm going to say something sort of tongue in cheek. You know, being a nerd, you're kind of weird anyway, right? Go for it. Don't worry so much about what people are going to think. Because that's what we do. We think about, okay, how am I going to appear? We spend so much time worrying about stuff that we shouldn't worry about that we cut ourselves off from opportunity. So I want you to not be your own problem. There are going to be enough challenges out there, and failure is not fatal. I learned some of my best lessons. I got some of my best wisdom from just screwing up. I'm not saying go screw up, but give yourself space to iterate and understand that there's some amazing lessons you're going to learn when you try and you don't quite make the mark. Try again, take that wisdom and move forward. So I just want to say, unfortunately, we're out of time. You know, and as I always say, I have the most fun here. This is my fun, because I get to speak with amazing women who are doing amazing things. And I'm so grateful to you, Michelle, Samantha, and Megan. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you for sharing your experiences, talking about amazing products and how they're changing our lives. And I just want to thank everybody for joining us today. For all of you who come every time, I'm so grateful for your loyalty. For those of you who are new, thank you for coming. Come on back next time. This month, it has Thanksgiving in it. So we're going to skip ahead to the 1st of December on Giving Tuesday. Please hope to see you there. Also, remember that we're a nonprofit. We do a lot of amazing things. Remember our Tech Journey Fund. If you want to help a woman to stay in school, to have the support that she needs, please go to our site, anitab.org, and make a donation on behalf of someone to keep her in school. In the meantime, thank you so much to everyone on this panel. Thank you, panelists. Thank you for everybody that's joined us today. And we will see you next time. Bye.
Too late, got nothing in my brain. That's what people say. Mm-mm. That's what people say. Mm-mm. I go on too many dates, but I can't make them stay. At least that's what people say. Mm-mm. That's what people say. Mm-mm. But I keep cruising, can't stop, won't stop moving. It's like I'm a hater.